dear sons and daughters, to another weekly episode of NAR Logos. Good to see all of you today. I thank God that you are watching this program, and I thank you for all the wonderful reports and comments that you are writing about this program, how it's been useful to you, and how you are edified and how you are growing in the Lord. This program, NAR Logos. NAR is a Hebrew word meaning youth, and Logos is a Greek word meaning talk. It's a platform where the youth are being trained. So it's a talk show. It's a platform where the youths are trained to be part of the last day's army of God. Since it's an army, there are some qualities that are necessary to be a soldier in the army of God. Like in the natural, so is it in the spiritual. The qualities are the same, but the values may differ because purpose differs. In a spiritual army, eternity counts. In a natural army, dollars and cents counts. So, being a soldier in the army of God, there are some characteristics that God requires. And one of the characteristics that we are going to meditate today is obedience. So we have in our studio many young people who have come. We are going to bounce this question to them, what it means to obey. And before that, let's get to know them. Okay, could you introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Nishan from India.
Hi, Nishan, how are you? Good. And?
Hello, I'm Angela.
Hello, Angela.
From the U.S.
From the U.S.
I'm David from India.
David from India.
Hi, I'm John from the U.S.
Oh, I thought you were going to say, I'm Goliath from the U.S.
No.
John from?
John from the United States.
And this lady?
I'm Aarti from India.
Aarti from India.
I'm Jana from the U.S.
Jana from U.S.
I'm Solomon from India.
Solomon from India.
I'm Brittany from the U.S.
And Brittany from U.S. Thank you, everybody, for coming to our talk show. We have been discussing about this topic, about obedience. And for the past few weeks, many of you have shared your opinions concerning what it means to obey, what it means not to obey. And you have really been put to the test, or rather flawed to the test. Like being in a reality show where you really examine your heart, the very inner core value of your heart, which you may not have done before. And finally, you realize that you were not really that kind of a toughie that you thought you were. When you suddenly realize deep down inside you, hey, I am not that tough guy. You know, there's some cracks or weakness inside me that still needs some strengthening. You know, that is why I believe the Apostle Paul admonished the last day church, saying, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Because the battle is going to be the thickest, the hottest, and the most fiercest, like none has ever seen before. Let me give an example. Now, the prophet Daniel, he was thrown into the lion's den, right? For what reason? David?
Failed to obey the king.
Ah, obedience, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, a test for obedience. Now, tell me, Brittany, if the same test was given to today's cheap grace Christian, what would they do?
They probably wouldn't obey.
Or would they close all their windows, close all their doors, and whisper a prayer? Which would they do?
Maybe they would pray.
Maybe whisper.
Yeah.
Solomon, what do you think they will do?
I think that's probably what they'd do.
They'll whisper.
In secret, they might pray.
And they will say, we have to be wise as serpent, right? This is how we deceive ourselves, no? We try to deceive ourselves. No, we have to be wise as serpent. See, the Lord Jesus said that. So we have to be very wise, isn't it? So whenever, you know,
when I hear Christians say like that, I used to think, poor Daniel didn't know how to be wise. Right? He went straight to his house. As soon as the law was passed, he opened the windows. And before the view of all, he knelt down, he lifted up his hands and prayed as if nothing happened. He wasn't afraid. So why is it that prophets of the old who did not count the cost were willing to pay whatever price it was to follow God all the way through? Whereas today, when the Holy Spirit is so freely given to everybody, the gifts of the Spirit are given freely to everybody, the anointings of God that rest upon Samson is upon every one of us today. When we have the greatest treasure within us, or the greatest power within us, yet we lack that kind of tenacity, that kind of a boldness that the older saints possessed. So what's the difference? Why is it that we don't have that kind of a boldness to be bold and to be confident that we are willing to obey at all costs? Why is it not possible? Jenna?
I don't know. Really, I don't think that there's any good excuse for that. I think we should. We should have the same boldness. We should be able to make the same choice. We should, that should be a core value in our heart, that no matter what the cost, no matter what it looks like, I'm going to obey. I'm going to stand for righteousness. I'm not going to compromise. Unfortunately, I don't think that's common at all, but I don't think that there's a good excuse for it.
Arti, what do you think? What is lacking in today's Christianity?
In today's Christianity, I think it's been diluted. The faith and our beliefs have been diluted with the worldly thoughts. As you said, we just concentrate on grace more than the righteousness of God. So in those days, they had this concentrated, strong faith. Today it's diluted.
Now, let's answer this question. What really is obedience? What would you say? What is obedience?
Submission to authority.
Submission to authority. Okay, Jenna?
It's like volunteering to submit to authority. Yeah, because you can be ruled over and forced to submit, but that's not obedience. Mm-hmm. You know, that's like you can be a slave and technically be obeying, but that's not obedience. It's when I choose to give myself to something.
Okay, David?
I believe it's like taking heed and taking orders.
Mm-hmm. Angela?
Responding in love to the will of the Father.
Mm. Brittany?
I think it's like living a laid down life and just being willing to do whatever the leader or the Lord is asking you.
Arti?
It's doing something which sometimes we don't want to do or we don't like to do.
Mm. John?
Well, I think it's submitting our own will or our own desires or feelings and laying that down before the Lord and choosing to desire and carry His desires and His heart.
Ishi?
Do something that you don't like to do, but for the sake of relationship, you do that.
Mm. Okay, I have here with me a dictionary definition of what obedience means. It says here, a person or animal who is obedient does what they are told to do. Whether it's an animal or whether it's a person, obedience is they do what they are told to do. For example, I'm sure you may have seen trained dogs. You know, when the master snaps his finger, the dogs eat. When he snaps a finger, it stops eating. Or if he snaps his finger, he says, sit, it sits. I'm sure you have seen it, right? That's a trained dog, trained to obey. But something can be forced upon, and something can be a voluntary that flows out of a heart of love. You don't want to do it, but you choose to do it because you love the object for whom or for which you want to obey. Agree, everybody? I think a very good example is Abraham leaving his father's house. In Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 and 4 to 5 says that when God told him, come out of your father's house. You know, in the Western culture, to leave is not an issue. But in an Eastern Oriental culture, everybody lives in a extended family. You know, they have three or four families all living jointly together. Grandfather, mother, uncles, aunts, everybody's staying is one huge tribe. That's how Abraham was living. And for him to hear, Abraham, come out of your father's house. For him to take the step, leaving everything behind. It's not just the father's house, you know. It's the security of a roof over the head. And Abraham was not a single man. He was married without kids. So he has a wife. So now he's to step out. And before they stepped out, his wife asked him, honey, where are we going? So he said, I don't know. Okay, she said, follow him. After second day, she would have asked him, honey, where are we going? She said, I don't know. Can you imagine the scenario? You know, it's humorous on one side. The difficulty Abraham had. But when he obeyed, it was an unquestioning obedience. That's what real obedience is all about. Implicit obedience. You don't question. You know, in an army, you obey your superiors without questioning. When they said, jump, you jump. If they say, kill, you kill. You don't ask questions. That's what military law states. You jump the wagon. Now, if you look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8, it says, by faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. Now, tell me, young people, is it possible to obey like that today? Is it possible?
Yeah.
So if God would tell you, Nishi, come out of your wife's house, you, your wife, and your newborn son, 1-day-old son, come out. And won't you ask the Lord, where, Lord?
Yeah, I would.
You would, no? And the Lord would say, just go.
It has happened to me before. So.
It has happened to you before. But was your wife there with you? What did she ask you?
She asked me, what is the reason? She also waited for the Lord and then got an answer. But she also had the question.
Where to?
What is tomorrow?
Ah, there you see. There you see. Then what happened next?
Then she got a revelation on what the Lord wants us to do.
So she followed you?
Yeah.
Okay, that was all easy, no? Now you'll have a little baby this size, right?
Yeah.
What are you going to do next?
Yeah.
Ah, this is something.
You'll have questions then.
Ah. Isn't it, Brittany? Abraham stepped out. Why do we call him today father of faith? Because of that decision he made that day. If he did not make the decision that day, if he chose to step back, God would have picked someone else to be a father of the Jewish nation. But Abraham would have lost that high price of his calling. This man called Abraham. Because the call was given to him first. Just like, you know, if you look at the life of Peter. In Acts chapter 9, we read that when Peter was praying, he saw a sheet of white cloth come down from heaven. And there were all kinds of animals. And a voice said, eat. He said, no, how can I do that? I'm a religious Jew. This vision was repeated to him 3 times. And he didn't eat at all. Eventually, an opportunity came for him to preach to Cornelius' family. He did. And the Spirit of God fell upon them. They all got filled in the Holy Spirit. After that, Peter did not pursue in that calling to go among the Gentiles. So when he refused, that call went straight over to the Apostle Paul. See, God raised up someone else because Peter failed. But the first choice went to Peter. He was given the first choice. But because he refused, no, I will not. It went over to the next person. The person in the next choice. But who was God's first choice? Peter. Peter was the first choice. So likewise, in every one of you, even all those who are watching from home, there would have been a circumstance in your life where you would have received the first choice call or the first choice opportunity. If you had blown it, the kingdom of God will not suffer a loss because you refused to do it. It would have gone to the next person in waiting, the number 2 person in the list. You know, recently there was an athletic race, and one of the runner, the 4th person, suddenly got the 3rd prize. You read that in the papers? Because the first runner was disqualified. So when the first runner disqualified, the 2nd became the 1st, the 3rd became the 2nd, and the 4th became the 3rd. The 1st person was disqualified, so everybody else got pushed up. But the 4th person was really 4th. But because the 1st person was disqualified, that medal went to the next person. So the call goes to the next person. Remember, God is never at a loss for people. But because of his great love for you, he gives you the first choice call. Jenna, will you do this for me? But I don't know. You know, I really like my family. They're all so sweet to me. You know, there's never been a salt in our family. Everybody are just so sweet. I don't think, you know, Lord, please, while you're dragging your feet, someone like Elijah, with the Spirit upon him, would have run ahead of Ahab. See, you are like Ahab in the chariot. Because you are dragging your feet, God cannot wait for you in these last days. That includes me too. He cannot wait for anybody in these last days. Remember, in a couple of weeks ago, I told you, this is the last race, the last lap. And you guys are the last generation. We don't have a second chance. No second chance. It's either you make it or you don't make it. If it's not you, God has somebody else to replace you. But you are his first choice. And for you to be part of the first choice, he requires absolute obedience from us. Just like what Abraham did. We must be willing to pay whatever cost it requires, like what Abraham did. See, look at Abraham. In Hebrews 11:8 says, he went out not knowing where he was going. He didn't know, but he knew just one thing. He had to obey. What do you think, John?
I think it's something that we really should be thinking about, because there's no difference between these biblical characters like Abraham and us today. And so I think that it's important for us to see that, you know, if the Lord was to ask of us to do something like that, not just something huge, but just faith in general, just obeying, just moving when he says move and trusting him on daily issues, I think that it has to be a yes, you know? Otherwise, it will be like Abraham was maybe the one out of the thousands, you know? And it would be a tragedy for that to happen in our generation in this last days when the Lord's calling all of us to move together as an army.
Mm. Brittany, you seem to be deep in thoughts. What do you think?
Yeah, I think that if we love the Lord and want to serve the Lord, that we have to obey, like, no matter what it looks like or feels like, we can't, like, choose what to obey and what not to obey. We have to, like, just be wholehearted in all that we do.
So if you would ever get a call like that, you would throw everything up in the air and just pack your bags and walk up to the Lord without asking any questions?
I would hope that I would.
Say again, please.
I would hope that I would.
You are hoping, but you don't know whether you will do it.
Well, I know that I love the Lord and that I would want to do it.
So you would?
I would say yes.
David, you look so handsome and so full of life, so full of ambitions ahead of you. What would you do?
To be honest, as you said, if I'm going to be put in such a situation, it'll definitely be such a the decision I'm going to take is going to change my life. But to go with God is always better.
That so will be you obey or not?
I would obey.
Or you don't know?
I would obey.
You would. Why are you staring at me, Solomon? Are you looking at all your PhDs that are going to fly away or what? Okay, what would you do? Or what do you think about what Abraham did?
I think if we are God's first choice for something, if because of disobedience we lose that first choice position, I think that would be the greatest tragedy of our life, of our lives. And I think that I wouldn't want to be in that place. So I better obey God, you know.
Look, people, I want to correct a word that Solomon said. Listen carefully. It is not if you are God's first choice. You are God's first choice. It's not if. I can say for sure you guys are God's first choice because you are the last generation. There's not going to be another generation. You are the last day's army of God. The last person with the baton who's going to cross the finishing line. You guys are the last runner. So it's not if, you are. So if you are, the question is, can I? Am I? That is the question. Am I willing to obey at all costs? That's the question. Jenna.
I think that's so important. One thing I know I've settled is, Lord, I know I don't know how to do it all, but I am willing. Like, I am absolutely willing, and I want to, whatever that looks like. I know it'll cost more than anything that's cost me now. You know, I think we're growing in that. I know it's going to cost more than I could imagine, but I'm willing, you know.
Angela, you're giving me that look again.
I'm deep in thought again.
How do you feel?
I feel like for me, because I've been humbled so many times just in that area of obedience, I've just like taken it back quite a few steps to where I'm more so focusing on obeying the Lord in the little things and believing in faith that as I continue to do that, my obedience will grow to where the next time he asks me to do something big, I'll actually be trained up and prepared to be able to do that.
You know what? Ever since we started this program, she's the most honest person. David, you know, in that big body of yours, how many heart do you have?
One heart.
One heart, no? And in that one heart, there's room only for one person.
Sure.
Right? It's either the devil or the Lord Jesus, right? It's either the world or the Lord Jesus. You don't have another heart to share with someone. Am I right, David?
Right, right.
So, whether we choose to obey or not, it depends who is sitting here. Isn't it?
Right.
Who is sitting here? To whom you have given your heart. See, like a young girl or a young man. You know, before they fall in love with someone, their heart is open for anyone. But once they have fallen in love with someone, their heart has been given to that someone. And they will not think of another man or another woman because their heart has been given to that someone. Likewise, if your heart is unreservedly given to the lordship and rulership of the Lord Jesus Christ, then the king has the last say. You know, I want you guys to think for a moment what I'm going to say now. Is the Lord Jesus Christ just a savior to you, or he's a Lord to you? All of you at home, we are going to go for a short little break now. I want you to think right now the same question that I ask these young people. Is the Lord Jesus Christ a savior to you or a Lord to you? Write to me on the address that you see on your screen, and we'll be back after a short break. Welcome back, my dear sons and daughters. Do you remember what I asked you earlier? Is the Lord Jesus Christ a savior to you or a Lord to you? Nishi, tell me. Is he a savior to you or the Lord to you?
He should be both my Lord and savior. If he's just my savior, then it means that I'm not dead to self. I want the Lord to serve me rather than me serving the Lord. Mm-hmm. So he should be my Lord and savior.
Okay. John, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree. I think as a disciple of Christ, he has to be our Lord and our savior, but it's not easy. It's similar to Abraham, like we've been talking. Sometimes the Lord asks the most wild things. They're so, you know, out there and so difficult. And it is difficult. It's very hard. But at the same time, as a disciple of Christ, to know the Lord, we have to allow him to rule us.
Arti, is the Lord a savior or the Lord?
A savior? Not Lord exactly, because if I place him as a Lord for me, then he should be my Lord and he should control me 100%. But right now, that's not the condition.
Okay, Brittany, is Jesus Christ just a savior to you or is the Lord of your life?
Savior and Lord of my life.
No, it's either or.
Either or? Okay. I would say Lord of my life.
Lord. Solomon, is he just a savior to you or the Lord of your life?
Am I supposed to say just one?
Yeah.
This is a really hard question. I would say Jesus is my Lord.
You know, I'm forcing you guys to think, to see deep in your heart where we are. Not just you, all those who are watching this program. You know, we should stop playing church. Okay, we are not here to play games. In this end times, you're going to face the devil face to face. It's no more shadow boxing. That happened in the past. That happened in my generation. It was shadow boxing. But you guys are going to face the real enemy. If you're going to face a real enemy, your Christianity must be real. It cannot be just wishy-washy. So in order to be real, I'm forcing you to see deep inside you. Who you really are, what you are really made of. Are you a spongy or are you the real stuff? So tell me now.
I would like to say Jesus is my Lord, but then I realize that many times, you know, I call upon him as Savior more than I submit myself to him as my Lord. So if either or, I would have to reconsider now and say that Jesus is my Savior. because I find myself running to him often, asking him to save me. I mean, more times than I have submitted myself to him as my Lord.
Jenna.
My answer would have to be similar to his. I would love to say that my life is fully submitted to the Lordship of Christ, but I know that there's areas in my heart that he's still asking of. I'm still trying to submit.
David.
I would go with Solomon, as he said. I want him to be my Lord, but often we do fail. And again, we say, Lord, be my Lord, like that. So it is a daily thing with what we need to do. We need to ask him to be our Lord. So this is my desire, that he needs to be our Lord, though he is not at the moment, but that is my ultimate goal. I should have him as my Lord.
Angela.
He's becoming my Lord, but right now he's my Savior.
I firstly want to appreciate all of you for your very frank and honest answer. You are becoming a true soldier because you have started to honestly see inside you. That is the first step towards becoming a soldier. When you start recognizing who you are, when you start seeing what is missing inside you, then you can throw yourself at the feet of the Lord and cry to him for help. Now, if the Lord Jesus Christ is the Lord of our lives, then comes another question. Then why are we not obeying him? Because as the Lord, he has absolute right over our lives. Because he owns you. He's the Lord, right? So why are we not obeying him? Why do we throw fleeces before him? Why do we want to say, Lord, you know, I need second confirmation. I need third confirmation. Like what Nishi said earlier, he already knew that the Lord had clearly spoken to him. But he was trying to evade that commitment or evade paying the price. Because of that, he said, no, speak to my wife, speak to my father, speak to my mother. Next time he said, speak to my son. Isn't it? Now, come on, guys, think. If he is the Lord of our lives, why can't we obey? It's not so much why we can't obey. The question is why we don't want to obey.
I think because in this world, especially as Christians right now and in America, I think we're building according to the natural. Everything that we're doing in the church in our lives, you know, we're going to church instead of being the church. We're, you know, we're like we've been saying, it's so easy for us to accept the Lord as our Savior and not as our Lord. And we're living lives that are so invested into the natural. We sow to the flesh all the time. And it makes it so difficult, you know, to then move when he requires something that's costly to us, something that affects our soul or our lives.
You see.
Well, we don't love the Lord the way we should because he is everything for us. We know the truth that he is everything and we're going to spend eternity with him. But this thought goes away from us that he is everything for us and we need the genuine love of the Lord that the prophets of the old had. They worked on faith that worked with love. So we don't have that love.
Jenna.
I think it's self. When I look at my own the reasons I haven't submitted in areas to the Lordship of Christ, I think it's because I let my flesh get in the way, myself, saving myself, governing myself, choosing to obey that rather than obey the Lord.
David.
Obeying the Lord, it is like we always want to be independent. We always want to listen to ourselves. And when we are being independent, we can say we are taking responsibility for our actions. But again, if we are going to put the Lord as our Lord, we know that we are going to let ourselves humble and then we are going to give him the control over our lives. And then we cannot take control of what we were doing in the past. But that is something like we are not accustomed to, that new change, the uncertainty, the insecure feeling or
something new which is going to happen in our lives. We are not ready to face that. I could say that is according to me why we are like not giving ourselves completely into His presence.
You know, as I hear you guys speak, and as I look back at my own life and look at the hundreds of churches that I've been to in the last 35 years of my ministry and seeing thousands of believers, I think the honest answer is we are just being hypocrites in church. We're just hypocrites. We pretend to love the Lord. In reality, we don't. We pretend to obey. In reality, we don't. We pretend to be holy. In reality, we don't. So, our entire Christian life is one big fat lie. We merely profess a religion, but we lack the relationship. You know, as you guys were giving your answers, the thought that came to my mind is this. The church at large has failed to really bring out the true message of the cross. You know, I remember when I got saved, and our pastor was teaching the new believers class for Sunday school, you know. So there were about 10 of us, and he started teaching us. The very first book that I read in a new believer was the book of Revelation. But I remember one day when he opened the Sunday class, somehow the topic went from the book of Revelation to the cross. And our pastor made this statement. He said, "I recommend all of you to read the book called The Cost of Discipleship by Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a German theologian and a martyr." He said a statement. Now, this happened in 1979, and it has never departed from my life all these years. The theme of the book is, when Christ calls a man to come, He calls him to come and die. That is the price of discipleship. When Christ calls a man, come, He calls him to come to die. That is what the Lord Jesus said, take up your cross and follow after me. What is the cross, David?
Your old ways, leaving that and carrying the new salvation.
You know why I keep on asking you all the questions? My favorite nephew's name is David.
Praise God.
So tell me,
yeah,
what is the cross?
Cross is the new life which you have got from the salvation.
Ah, you see? New life, salvation. What is the cross?
Death.
Your answer is not wrong. It's right, but it is wrong. It is right, but we, the leadership, have taught you wrongly. Your answer is right. The cross is death. The symbol of the cross, the Lord Jesus glorified it. Resurrection. But there is no resurrection if there wasn't a death in the first place. Right? First comes death. Then comes the resurrection. If there's no death, there wasn't a resurrection. So when the Lord says, take up your cross, He's saying to you, die! Die! If you're not willing to die, you cannot follow me. You must die to your passions. You must die to your desires. You must die to your ambitions. You must die to this. You must die to that. You must die to everything. Even to the very life that you are. To your very identity, who you are. Die! Only then you can follow me. Only then you can have true life. If you are not willing to die, then you cannot follow me. You know, when the Lord Jesus called Peter and James, Peter, Andrew, James, John. The scripture says they had a thriving fishing business. And they were with their father mending the nets because they had a huge catch. But when the Lord Jesus said, come, follow me, the Bible says they gave up their boats, they gave up their father, and they just followed after the Lord Jesus. What security could the Lord Jesus give to these guys? Nothing, right? He just said, follow me. Here they had a thriving business, thriving industry, big shipping company. In those standards, big company. They gave up everything to follow. Dying. Look at Matthew. He had a MBA, CA. He had a chartered accounting business. When the Lord Jesus walked past by him, he was busy on his computer, putting all the accounts on tally, you know. And while he was entering the data, the Lord said, come, follow me. You know, he didn't even have time to shut down his computer. He just left his iPad and he walked away. Okay, tell me guys, what made Peter, Andrew, James, John, Matthew just instantly give up everything and follow? Why is it that in today's Christianity, we are not able to do that? Why is it that we are pretending to be a Christian? Why are we pretending to be holy? Why are we pretending this? We are pretending that our entire Christian life is one big fat, not Greek wedding, big fat lie. Big fat lie. Isn't it, Angela? Big fat lie. John? Brittany? Solomon? Jenna? It's one big fat lie. When is it going to end? It must end. It must end with me, and it must begin afresh with you. Because you are going to finish. You are going to cross the finishing line. I have passed the baton to you. My job is to pass the baton to you. My job is to apologize to you for the mistakes that all the other previous generation has made. To erase them all and to put before you new path, new shoes, and say, this is the way, walk in it. This is the path. Look at the captain of the salvation of your souls before you. Look at the line of Judah going before you. Follow him. In order to follow the line of Judah, then you must die. You must be willing to be crucified. You must be willing to give up all. Take up your cross. Implicit obedience. Without question. Here I am, Lord. I'm willing to die. Willing to follow. Are you willing to do that? My dear sons and daughters who are watching this program. How is your Christianity? I recommend that you get this book, The Cost of Discipleship, and read it, and you will know one thing at the end of the book. You will be willing to take up the cross. Either you will throw away that book because your Christian life is a lie, or you will fall yourself on the face before God and allow yourselves to be crucified. We are going to continue this topic next week, and I want you to write to me what you feel about what we have been discussing. You see the email ID on the screen, or you can post your comments on our Facebook, or you can write a mail to the address that you see on your screen. God bless you all till we meet again next week.